Good afternoon. There has been a show of force in the Hunter Valley. Friends and family of the wedding bus crash victims visiting the site of the horror accident. Nine's Lizzie Pearl was there when Premier Chris Minns arrived to pay his respects.
Well, after this horrendous wedding bus tragedy, which claimed the lives of 10 people, some extraordinary work has gone into clearing the crash site. The road has been cleared, making way for a memorial filled with flowers, notes and messages for victims, the survivors and their families. The Red Cross is taking care of the scene here. It's been a slow, steady and sombre stream of locals, families, children on their way to school, taking a moment, laying some flowers, leaving a note or even shedding a few tears, perhaps taking a few moments of silence and trying to make sense of what happened here. Among the people here at the scene today, the Premier, Chris Minns, who was flanked by local MPs from the Hunter and Cessnock regions, as well as the local mayor. He took some time here and also made an announcement of a $100,000 donation to the local Rotary Club fundraiser on behalf of New South Wales taxpayers. The money raised will go to victims, families and survivors of this horrific crash, which claimed 10 lives and left many more in hospital.
I think it's indicative of how wonderful this local community is and how close-knit they are. And when somebody's in trouble, people drop everything at the drop of a hat to ensure that the community in Cessnock and Singleton is there to represent the local community.
There are just so many people hurting in our community, but we're resilient here in the Hunter Valley. We're resilient in Australia, and I've been getting calls from interstate as well. People really want to get behind us, and that's what we do. That's what we do in Australia. We help the battler, we help those who are down, and we try and give them a hand up and support them the best we can.
Also visiting at the scene today, Health Minister Ryan Park, who says drop-in centres offering disaster and mental health support services will be open in Singleton and Brankston.
When cameras and lights and sirens go, that this community is going to need a fair amount of support and wrap their arms around them. That's what I'm going to try and make sure we put in place.
13 people remain in hospital after this accident. A number of passengers on board the wedding bus were part of the local Singleton Roosters Australian Football Club. As a mark of respect, AFL Hunter Central Coast has cancelled all seniors matches this weekend. The Red Cross is taking care of this memorial, making sure each note that is left is photographed and preserved, eventually to be put into a book and given to the families. There is also talk of a permanent memorial here on the roadside.
Murder charges against the man accused of killing German backpacker Simone Strobel 18 years ago have been dropped. The DPP revealing it isn't proceeding with the case against Tobias Moran. Simone's body was found in a Lisbon caravan park in 2005. She was Moran's girlfriend at the time. He was charged with her murder last year, but has always denied any involvement in her death. This afternoon, Moran's family spoke about new evidence, and we'll have those later details coming up very shortly. Well, Donald Trump, the first US president to face federal criminal charges, today stayed silent during a Florida court appearance over his alleged handling of classified documents. But the silence didn't last long. Our US correspondent Alison Petrowski reports.
Well, Donald Trump came out swinging at his fundraising event at his Bedminster golf course. He took aim at the Espionage Act. He believes he should be charged under the Presidential Records Act. He says under that act, he was allowed to do what he did. As president, he's allowed to declassify whatever he wants. As for the boxes that the FBI took during their raid in Mar-a-Lago last year, he says the boxes were full of personal belongings, shorts, shirts, shoes, photos from the White House, things that he says he didn't have time to unpack because I have a very busy life. Here's what he had to say about the charges in the indictment.
Today we witness the most evil and heinous abuse of power in the history of our country. Very sad thing to watch. A corrupt sitting president had his top political opponent arrested on fake and fabricated charges of which he and numerous other presidents would be guilty. Right in the middle of a presidential election in which he is losing very badly.
The arraignment took 48 minutes. Donald Trump was silent throughout. He sat with his arms folded, listening, and it was his lawyer, Todd Blanche, who stood up to plead not guilty for the president to all of those 37 counts listed in the indictment. As Donald Trump left court, a sea of fans had gathered outside the garage where his motorcade pulled out, and at one moment a protester dashed towards his car, an anti-Trump protester dressed as a prison inmate. He was tackled very quickly by police and brought to the ground. But look, it was mainly pro-Trump people who attended today. Florida is certainly his home turf. Let's hear what they had to say.
It's one of the worst things since probably President Kennedy and Lincoln were assassinated. This is basically a life sentence.
I've never seen one person persecuted as much as he has been persecuted.
Before Donald Trump headed to Bedminster, he made a quick pit stop at a Cuban cafe nearby. It was filled with Donald Trump fans, and he bought them all food. They chanted USA, USA together, they prayed together, and they sang him happy birthday, being that Donald Trump turns 77 tomorrow. Donald Trump appeared to be in a very jovial mood, given the grave circumstances that he faced that morning, and somehow he's managed to turn a historic and sad event for the country into a campaign pit stop.
A Queensland woman who disappeared while hiking in Canadian bear country has been found dead. Julia Mary Lane from Brisbane was last seen setting off on a walk on Saturday afternoon near the town of Kimberley in British Columbia. In a social media post, the 24-year-old's brother Connor said the family had lost their beautiful baby girl in an unfortunate accident. A load of laundry has sparked the evacuation of a unit block in Surry Hills, with 30 people fleeing the building after a small fire broke out. A blaze took hold in the dryer of the seventh floor apartment in Goulburn Street at around 7:11 last night. Firefighters using fans to clear smoke on the floor. Thankfully, though, no one was hurt. After a challenging start to the week, the federal government has just finalised an extension of the price cap on domestic gas. Let's bring in our federal politics reporter, Rhys Alessandro. Rhys, good afternoon. What does this mean for households?
Davina, for households, the government says these temporary interventions are keeping prices in check. For the government itself, they're a welcome distraction in this final sitting fortnight before the winter break. So far, it has been dominated by accusations Finance Minister Katie Gallagher tried to weaponise the rape allegation of former Liberal staffer Brittany Higgins. She has unequivocally denied those claims, and the focus is now turning to energy. Labor unveiling the final version of its mandatory gas code of conduct. In it, the $12 per gigajoule price cap Labor introduced is being extended to 2025, and that's been the subject of some debate in Question Time this afternoon.
Expert after expert making the point that it is directly the intervention of the government which has led to this bill relief. Expert after expert has said it is the intervention of the government. It's policy which reduces power prices, not foghorn, leghorn interjections in the peanut gallery. It's policy interventions which reduce power prices.
The minister will pause.
Also on pause, the government's flagship Housing Australia Future Fund. The Greens are still demanding more outright investment each year and a Commonwealth-funded state-legislated rental freeze before they support it in the Senate. It had crossbench support to get through the lower house, but some of those crossbenchers are now also calling on the government to establish a citizens' assembly to hear directly from those who are struggling.
We don't believe that the government or the opposition or the Greens or any of the parties have enough on housing affordability, and we think that it's really important that we get affordable housing for all Australians.
Middle ground clearly remains a long way off. In fact, Senate debate on the housing bill, Davina, has been postponed to next week.
That's the last thing the country needs. OK, Rhys, thank you.